Hello, this is Hot Indonesia, and welcome to all of you watching us in Perth. I'm Dalton Tanonok in Jakarta, and here is this week's HI Hot List. Numbing numbers. As coronavirus cases stay at record levels, is the reality better or worse? Paradise found. Was the online war of words over an overstaying American in Bali justified? And video vice. This singer is a suspect in a porn case for a private moment that went public. Here are my co-hosts this week, Sanjina Malikiano, Deputy CEO of Polmark Indonesia from her home in South Tangerang. And joining us this week is Marcelia Lasar from Manado in North Sulawesi. She's a clinical hypnotherapist by day and jazz singer at night. And a good one. Hot topic number one, numbing numbers. Coronavirus cases remain near record highs. The positivity rate is 5 to 6 times higher than the global recommended threshold of 5%. And now the government says the data collection is not functioning perfectly, pointing to delays in getting reports from all regions in the country. Sanjina, does this mean the situation could be better or worse?
Dalton, to answer to your question, will the situation be better or worse, really depends on how successful we can implement the three T's, testing.
No, my yeah. question was not will it be, but is it now? Do the numbers?
Yeah. So it depends on the testing, tracing, and treatment. Related to this, honestly, I personally fear that the situation tends to worsen. Why? We continue to carry out testings. That is why, based on data, the number of cases continue to grow. Unfortunately, the continued testing doesn't only mean that the government is increasing its concern and responsibility, but behind the situation, there is this business phenomenon, Dalton, namely import of medical, hospital, and lab equipment. People could easily assume that there are hidden business interests, for example, behind the antigen swab test or PCR swab test, which have been made compulsory for anyone who plan to travel by air. The validity of these tests have continued to be trimmed two times 24 hours for the validity of antigen swab test, 3 days for a PCR test. Even more extreme if you want to fly to Bali, only 1 times 24 hours prior to departure for the antigen test. PCR test results must be not more than 2 days old. Based on these facts, how can one not feel that there are business interests embedded in these regulations? Meanwhile, we never have been serious enough when it comes to managing contact tracing. We do not have a tracing system that is as powerful and as effective as in China, Singapore, South Korea, or Australia and New Zealand. Therefore, tracing has not been done effectively. So we have not been able to track and put a stop on the spreading of the virus.
Now, Marcelia, as Sanjina said, you know, more testing, which would be good, would likely mean even more active cases. And that's fair to assume, right?
Well, it's fair to assume that, but the way I see whether the situation is either worsened or better as we speak is something that we ought to approach backward, I believe, because to speak about data collection, data integration, without talking about the methodology and barometers, indicators being used to gather this information, which has never been provided by the government, and that causes such a great sorrow to the public. And speaking of the lack of data collection or integration, we have been facing accountability crisis for nearly 10 months now. So to measure the quick count of how it is as per today, is we really need to come back to the root first and question first why there hasn't been such a, you know, fair accountability, let alone strong accountability.
Yeah, transparency in the collection of the data.
Yeah, transparency.
Sanjina,
I think transparency is a...
Sanjina knows about data collection and how to gather information from her polling company. Now Sanjina, I want to talk on a more personal level here. You know, I know people who haven't left their home in months, and I know people who are out and about meeting people. You know, they're wearing masks, but they're still out and about. What would you say is the risk factor out there, Sandrina?
This pandemic, Dalton, has continued to drastically change our lives. This is unavoidable. Who knows until when we'll have to continue to wear masks and practice social distancing. This pandemic has, in a revolutionary manner, formed a new culture we call the new normal for mankind. But this pandemic cannot put our social and economic activities on a full stop. In order to survive, people have to continue to earn a living, and humans are social creatures. People will continue to socialize. Similar to economic activities, the pandemic will not be able to totally eliminate social interactions or activities. So in order to manage the risk factors and put a stop to this pandemic, we have to ensure a good relation and management between three parties. First, the public sector or government. Second, the private or business sector. And third, the civil society. The government must take a bigger responsibility in making regulations that are people-oriented to ensure the safety of the people and the economic recovery. Business sectors must be made healthier. The government must demand that private sectors show their social responsibilities. Business orientation to gain profit must be balanced with their responsibilities to save lives. And the public, of course, they have to leave their ego behind.
But you go out sometimes, Sandrina, right? You go
yes, to the, yeah. But we have to be vigilant. People must protect one another by practicing health protocols.
So. Sure, of course. Continue to follow the guidelines. You know, Indonesia, as we know, has never been in a full lockdown. Marcelia, you're in Manado. What is it like there quickly as far as protocols?
Well, we are going through the large-scale social restriction as well until the end of the month for Manado. And we're getting news daily about the filling up of most hospitals around town with COVID-positive patients. So it's pretty much, Not too far apart from what's going on in Jakarta, except that the livelihood of people in the region versus in the big city is something you can distinguish easily. We're social creatures, as Sandrina says, and we find our ways. We work around the restriction to stay socially connected.
And that's why you kind of escaped to your hometown to get out of the big city to lower your risk. So we understand that.
Okay, you might say so.
Okay, Hot Indo will continue shortly with Paradise Found. Was race a factor in a Twitter battle with an American expat in Bali?
Trần Minh Ngân of VCTN Net Việt in Hanoi.
I'm Thairat Thomya of Thailand's Thairat TV in Bangkok.
I'm Monica Samborat from the National Television of Cambodia in Phnom Penh.
I'm Raymond Goh of Malaysia's TV Tiga in Kuala Lumpur.
I'm Glenda Chong of Singapore's Channel News Asia.
I'm Sachin Tommy of the Indonesia Channel at the ASEAN Secretariat in Jakarta.
This is your weekly look into the dynamic Southeast Asia region.
ASEAN Today on the Indonesia Channel.
Every week in this program, I will introduce you to one of Indonesia's fabulous food items.
Yummy.
Beautiful.
Now, I'm ready to cook. Let's go to the kitchen.
It's done. Let's meet to eat.
Foodiepedia on the Indonesia Channel.
I'm Caitlin Turner, and welcome to Yoga Bliss.
Dropping your hands to the mat, just step it back
and out and up to the sky.
Up through your fingertips.
Reach your right hand back behind your head.
Put your hands separate forward and then start.
Yoga Bliss, only on the Indonesia Channel. iPop on the Indonesia Channel.
You're watching Hot Indonesia with Sandrina, Marcelia, and me. Here's hot topic number two, Paradise Found. An American named Kristen Gray has been living and working in Bali in violation of her tourist visa. She offered advice for a fee on how to do what she did and sold a book online. Now, some Indonesians didn't appreciate what she was doing and unleashed a barrage of criticism online.
Through a Western lens, you could see the tweets on Twitter and think, oh, they hate black women or they hate black people. But Indonesians are trying to say that, no, it's because you're a Westerner and you don't realize the power dynamic that you have over us.
The woman was detained by authorities this week and has been deported at last report. Now, you know, ladies, I believe that the racial angle was without merit. I agree with the tweeter we heard from. This was about a visitor encouraging people to come here during a pandemic in violation of the law, right, Marcelia?
Yeah. Yes, but the way I see it is, I believe that overstayed foreigners is an evergreen case in Bali, but What really the public is talking about, amplifying on a very simple fact that when in Rome, you act like Romans, you know, and for the gentrification topic to be raised out of the situation, I think is highly ironic, because running from gentrification, a gentrification issue, to come to a foreign land just to implement the very thing you're running from, gentrification. With the natives as the victim of it, is highly condescending, in my opinion. And the statement being made by her is highly insensitive in a struggling society that is being hit the most, you know, in the country because of the tourism, the unsustainable tourism that is going on. And for her to endorse that to the world and making a lot of insensitive statement. This is just, it's just heartbreaking. But then on the other end, on a bright note, it's also a wake-up call to the law enforcement to correct a very permissive system that has been going on for a minute.
Yeah, and I think if she was quiet about it and just did her thing and didn't put it online, there would be no problem, really. It's still a violation. That's another thing. Sandrine, I want to ask you a little, your thought about the racial aspect of this real quickly. But mainly, I think the criticism was about the class differences that Marcelia pointed out and how this visitor described her life in a relatively low-cost environment. As Sel said, not very sensitive in these tough times.
I agree. As an Indonesian citizen, I must admit that there are loopholes and weaknesses in our legal system, including in immigration laws or regulations. But at the same time, I believe that the best ambassadors for Indonesia are all citizens who proudly speak for the good of the country. So I will try to speak as an ambassador here. Kristen Gray has taken advantage of the weakness in our legal system and immigration laws for her personal benefit. In this context, she made two fatal mistakes. Firstly, she definitely violated the law, so she must face the consequences. Deportation is the right step. She violated the tourist visa regulations, which forbids her from doing business in Indonesia. She also avoided the responsibility of paying taxes. Secondly, what she did was so insensitive, as Marcelia also underlined. by taking advantage of the situation amidst the extreme difficulties and challenges faced by the Indonesian people due to this pandemic. It is true, we need to improve our ways in dealing with this pandemic, but that doesn't give her the right to take advantage of the situation. Kristen Gray's identity as a minority Black American LGBTQ exponent who experienced oppression in her own country should not be used to justify her acts of violating the law and basic humanity principles in Indonesia. You see, Dalton, there's this Twitter account, expertindo.org, underlined this matter in their account at expat_indo. They wrote, "Hopefully she can see that while she is oppressed in her country, she is doing the same here. You can, even without ever intending to. Maybe this will help her better understand race relations in her own country."
Sure. Yeah, you're right about that. Now, Marcelia, you know, as Sanjuna said, Ms. Gray also wrote about Bali being queer friendly, while members of the LGBTQ community here said that is not the case, that many feel persecuted, and that this could be misleading to potential visitors.
I believe it's a wonderful alibi that is being presented with the LGBTQ statement. I think we have to return to the root of the problem, which was her insensitive behavior, you know, putting out threats in the midst of a struggling society and in the midst of the pandemic, putting the native on a disadvantaged situation. But I think to raise the LGBTQ, there will always be a pro and con, as in the LGBTQ-friendly, you know, topic or perspective. But yeah, I think that should be put aside, and she needs to return to the root of the problem instead of trying to establish alibi.
Yeah, you know, even our former co-host, Sandy Uno, now tourism minister, commented on this early in the week, saying that everyone must respect the law. And I think that's what we're all kind of pointing our focus to. But ladies, in any other time, I think what the American was saying would almost be kind of a positive advertisement for Bali, touting the welcoming environment for minorities and for all kinds of minorities, and that it's a place to work and do digital business, right, Sandrina?
I do agree that what Sandy said, we have to do the best that we can. But again, this situation is unique in terms of what this American tourist did in Bali. She shouldn't be given leniency, and this shouldn't be an example for others to do so, to do the same thing. We have to honor our own country and boost our tourism in a proper way.
Yeah, and again, for everyone watching outside of this country, it wasn't about race, it wasn't about sexual identity.
Indeed.
It was more about following the laws and respecting the culture. Okay, more Hot Indo is ahead with Video Vice. Does this artist deserve to go to jail for her private bedroom recording?
I'm Chen Mingan of Visitor Net Viet in Hanoi.
I'm Thairat Thomya of Thailand's Thairat TV in Bangkok.
I'm Monica Samborat from the National Television of Cambodia in Phnom Penh.
I'm Raymond Goh of Malaysia's TV Tiga in Kuala Lumpur.
I'm Glenda Chong of Singapore's Channel News Asia.
I'm Sachin Tommy of the Indonesia Channel at the ASEAN Secretariat in Jakarta.
This is your weekly look into the dynamic Southeast Asia region.
ASEAN Today on the Indonesia Channel.
I've a playlist.
iPop on the Indonesia Channel. Channel.
You're watching Hot Indonesia from Jakarta. Hot topic number 3, video vice. It was supposed to be a private moment when this singer recorded an intimate encounter. Gisela Anastasia said she then lost her phone and whomever found it posted the video online. She and her partner are now criminal suspects, as well as several people who are supposedly did post it online. Now, the country's anti-pornography law says transmission of explicit material is a crime, but Gisela's defenders say she's just a victim of stolen property. Where are you on this, Sandrina?
Dalton, our laws on such personal matters like this must be revised. From my perspective, Giselle committed no crime. The villains who committed crime are those who leaked or shared that private documentation, brought it into public space. From a moral point of view, Giselle and her partner could be seen as wrong, but come on, crossing moral boundaries doesn't always mean you have committed a crime or violated the law. From Giselle's case, once again, we find one sad fact, Dalton, regarding our legal or justice system. Law often does not stand independently as a tool to enforce justice for all. Laws and regulations have often been used as instruments by those with hidden agendas. People in power, strong business tycoons, or interest and pressure groups who hide behind morality and religious masks. When law serves these interests or agendas, it loses its course in the search of justice. If this happens, law becomes a tool to punish someone based on personal demands. So for me personally, people like Giselle, Jering, Ariel Noah, and many others are actually victims of a weak legal system.
Okay,
they're not criminals.
Yeah, as you said, though, from a moral aspect, and I want to ask Marcelia this, hardliners and moralists say that the couple should not have recorded their session in the first place. If they didn't, there'd be no problem. What do you say to that, Marcelia?
We're living in a very judgmental society, period. And being in the midst of patriarchy system, patriarchy society, is simply strengthening the whole legislation, which needs to be amended for certain. But it's funny that a woman can easily be put to trial or prosecuted when there were two people in the video making it, but then a woman is being prosecuted more.
No, he's also, he was also named the suspect. The guy.
He was.
Yeah.
But the moral obligation, the moral consequences is heavier on the woman's side over the male side, even though both of them are being presented as prosecutors. So this is actually a reflection of the society we're living in today that will easily expose women, because it's the second. That's why that's probably the reason why there's such a thing as human rights versus women's rights. It's ironic, because why there need to be a woman's rights if there is a human rights? Does it mean woman is not part of human, or does it mean that we're living under the illusion of woman being part of human, but actually human represent man only?
Yeah, no, very, very good point, Marcelli, and that's a topic for another day. The gender gap and the laws that apply to it. But I think we all agree that activists, along with activists, that the 2008 law needs to be amended, focusing solely on those who disseminate this kind of material. And I think the material itself is not even offensive. I mean, if you ask me, but that's another discussion. Okay, it is feedback time now, and we have this from Lynn in Washington, D.C. Posted this on our YouTube page. Amazing. Thanks for sharing. Well, thank you for watching and keeping up with what's going on here, Lynn. And Alan in Kuala Lumpur said this about our recent guest, Hendy Setiono of the Baba Rafi fast food chain. He is such a nice guy. Met him in KL at a conference. Agree, Alan. Hendy is that combination of nice and successful. Here's how to contact us with your feedback. Email at hotindo@theindonesiachannel.com. You do get a t-shirt if we get your email and read it on the air. Or comment through our Hot Indonesia or Indonesia Channel Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube pages. Final words, Sandrina.
Just 3 weeks into the new year of 2021, Indonesia has been hit by an array of natural disasters. Floods in 17 regions throughout the country: Kalimantan, Sulawesi, Sumatra, Java, and Maluku. More than 20,000 people displaced as they had to flee their homes in Kalimantan alone. Extreme weather conditions and heavy storms have hit Sumatra and Java. Landslides in parts of Sumatra, Java, and Sulawesi. Volcano eruptions in Java. And the recent earthquake in West Sulawesi. So we cannot deny the fact that destruction of nature, like deforestation, massive development with lack of proper planning, not nature-friendly, are just to name a few factors that have caused these natural disasters. You reap what you sow. We will harvest what grows from the seeds that we planted in the past. So this should be a very loud and alarming wake-up call for all. It is time for all of us to take action, take good care of nature. It is both our individual and collective responsibility to preserve and tend to Mother Nature.
Final words, Marcelia.
I wish for us all to continue to live life with as much hope as we can grasp, and to rectify meaning in the little things, to rectify the meaning of life, period. And it is a wonderful thing to notice how we as society are collectively humbled by the pandemic. Hence, we reevaluate our priorities in life, meaningful relationships, and to be as useful and as helpful to others in the best way we know how. So I wish us all the strength to overcome this, that I believe too shall pass. And blessings to all.
Yes. And my final words, short and sweet, best wishes to the new administration in the United States. Please heal us. And that is Hot Indonesia for this week. For Sandrina Malakiano and Marcelia Lasar, I'm Dalton Tananaka. Thank you for watching, and please join us again next time.